now may I request our third participant, Mr. Arijit, to please come.
Hi, Arijit. Kuldeep, this is Arijit. Yeah. Can you hear me well?
Yes, yes.
Can you hear me well?
Yes, yes, please.
Okay, so first of all, thanks for giving me this opportunity to talk with these eminent panel members. And we are going through an unprecedented time. I just wish that, you know, everyone is healthy and every family members are healthy and safe. This is such a wonderful way to kind of connect with each other and then, you know, go through this journey together and learn from each other. So thanks for hosting this. You asked me to speak about the NPDs, and many of the family members spoken about NPDs. I would like to say that, you know, what is NPD? To me, it's a process to unlock the deep consumer need. Deepak and Manish both mentioned about the size of NPDs, and you also touched upon that, you know, industry, how much industry needs to spend in R&D. So the global statistics is that average, the CPG companies spend about 1.3 to 1.5%. It could be in the range of 1 to 1.5%. Now, we never challenge ourselves that how much we should be spending to get the right return of investment. Deepak spoken about that 80% of the innovations, you know, which we bring to the market sometimes doesn't give or doesn't stay more than even 12 months. Just think about that. You know, you have an investment from your personal account, you're investing into something which doesn't give any, you know, ROI. So I think that's the things which we need to, as an R&D and NPD fraternity, needs to think about and ask ourselves that, is it about the investment which gives growth and drive volumes and prosperity? But it is not, in my view. I think it's about four things, you know, which as an NPD person, I would strongly urge all people who are in this conversation, listen to that. One thing is about deep consumer insights, and that's my personal experience over last 20 and more than 20 years. Many of the time, you know, we think about consumer insight not going through below the skin. You know, we think from our side that, you know, what could be the consumer need, and then go to the market and check with consumers to validate that. So validate our own views through them. That's not the right way to kind of understand the consumer insights. You know, I think the first point is about how do we really understand the deep consumer insights? So what is consumer really need from us, you know, in the industry? And there are many ways to do that. You know, and one of the things, you know, which we are always in the many of the CPG company follows, you know, which we call truth, motivations, and trust. You know, so what is the truth behind in front of the consumers? What is the motivations in the consumer's mind, and what is the real tensions in consumer mind, and how do we really, really solve the tensions? You know, I just give an example. Say example, how you know, my job is in Mumbai. I work with Mondelez. My technical center is at Thane. My office is in Mumbai. But currently, I am in Gurgaon with my family. That's the truth. You know, what's my motivation? My motivation is that I would like to go and see and meet my team, meet my folks who are at the center, personally meet them. You know, that's my motivations. You know, and also develop products, go there. You know, go into the pilot plan, go into the lab, you know, put myself to see, you know, if I can make something, etc., you know, which is part of my development process. That's my motivation. What's my tension? Tension is that I can't go because, you know, I always think about whether I would carry the virus, whether I would spread the virus, you know, if I go out. So I think it's about understanding the deep consumer insights, not just, you know, madly, mindlessly building innovations, you know, and that's not going to be effective. That's point number one to me, is about how do I effectively find out the deep consumer need. Second thing is about executions. You know, we know that if you ask 100 CEOs of the world, 80% will say that innovation is their top priority. But many of them, you know, I know 30% of the CEOs would say that yes, innovations I can effectively execute. So there is a big down in terms of from the innovations mentality to an innovation executions capability. So I would strongly urge and all the people who are in the call to see that you know, how they can really strengthen their muscles in the innovation executions. And what does it mean in the innovation execution is about an idea, a concept, which is coming out from an insight to an idea. And how do we take the ideas to different stage gates and then follow through after even the launch, you know? So many of the time, you know, we launch the products and we forget about that, okay? So that's not, I think that's then lead to a waste of investment, you know, which is not effective. So it's about how do I really execute in the market? And execution is not just an R&D responsibility, it's an enterprise accountability. It's an enterprise has to all put their minds and heads to really see how they can execute together. I like to bring the point number three, which I'm increasingly seeing in the last few years, and it is going to be more seen in the post-COVID world. It's about speed. Speed is the most important things. When I personally joined like 25 years back in the industry, the process of innovations was 2 years, 2.5 years. I think gone by the days in which the innovation is that long. We need to see how we can really execute in a very inexpensive way, in a very agile way, in a very nimble way, okay, to test and learn, okay? So I think that's the one piece which I would like to bring, that you're going to see many, many companies doing test and learn. And test and learn is not about launch. It's about real-time learning in the shelf, in the market, which we call is about transactional learning. You bring different options and scenarios because you don't know, you know. You got some weak signals from the consumer. You converted in a very agile way, in a very speed and you know, nimble and inexpensive way, and got some prototypes and ideas, you know, and then just take it to the market, learn from that, and then see that, you know, if you can incubate some of the ideas will fail. It's okay, you know. But you are doing it in a very inexpensive way, which is not going to be significantly eroding your incomes and expenditure. And that's the way I think the enterprise will help and support and grow. That's the point number three. The point number four, which I'd like to bring, which also Manish spoken at the last, is about the use of digital. Okay, we're going to see that, and we are already seeing a huge influx of digital, you know, which is modeling simulation, sensor based, IoT based, data access from the machine. And then instead of going into the lab, going into the factories for the plant trials, pilot trials, you are doing many of the simulations right in the computer, okay, to see that, you know, what's going to be the potential outcome. What it is solving, it is helping the speed. It is giving you a tool to experiment with various options and scenarios to find out what could be the potential options, you know, and then those you can take it to the lab and then experiments and, you know, massage a little bit more. Because we need to be careful that as the innovations and NPD is going to change into the next decades, we're going to see that the workforce pattern in the R&D is going to be changing. As Manish said, that, you know, he has somebody who doesn't have any food experience, and the same we have in our team as well, you know, and we're going to be seeing computer scientists, we're going to be seeing analytics, we're going to be seeing all those gigs into the workforce within the R&D, you know, working and part of the product development NPD innovations process. I'd like to touch upon a few more things, you know, which is Deepak spoken, is about food accessibility and food affordability. I also like to talk about food utilizations, that, you know, what is, especially in the COVID world, I am in my home, you know, I hardly get a time to go out and exercise, you know, I can't go to gym anyway. So I have to stay within my small area of the building. So I am not really utilizing my food. So it is important that, you know, how the consumers then really understanding that how much is the intake for me and how much I'm really utilizing, you know. You've spoken about a couple of things, you know, which I just would like to quickly touch upon is about regulatory challenges, Kuldeep. I would like to say it's more than the challenges, is about how do I use the opportunity of the regulatory world and use it as in my enablers to really see how do I drive innovations. We have seen an extreme cooperations from the regulatory authorities. I think, you know, if we bring back to them, you know, what's basically, you know, which we want, I think we're going to get a positive response from them. I just have a couple of quick notes, which is on the local part of it, you know, which local food, you know, and I think Manish spoken about that brilliantly. I just like to talk about the reason that, you know, why it is important, why local food is important, sometimes local flavor is important. It is, to me, is an association. The association which I trust, okay. You know, I have seen, you know, what's my practice in the home. I have seen my grandfather, grandmother eating. I have seen my parents eating. So that's obviously is a familiarity. So in the situations of COVID or the post-COVID, the trust is one of the important element. So anybody wants to give something, you know, which is going to accentuate the trust. And show me the familiarity, which I trust and I understand about the associations with that ingredient, associations with that, with the benefit, something, you know, which I would definitely, you know, go and accept it. That's my view. But I think brand also has a very important role to play. You know, it's about what is my brand purpose and what is the reason the brand exists and how do I really, really connect them together. Where I would see the future of NPD and how do I see, as I mentioned that there's going to be a lot of computer geeks working in the R&D. We're going to be seeing lots of test and learn happening in the marketplace. We're going to be seeing a smaller developmental time, but many, many iterations, you know, and learning from the consumers. You know, we're going to be seeing working with an external companies more and more, because we believe that, you know, the knowledge is so wide now, the need of the hour is so wide now, it's not exist, you know, in-house. So you have to go and understand 360 degree that, you know, who has and what's the insights from them and then bring it together. And that is the extreme important things now. A couple of quick things before I close is about, you're going to be seeing the ROI, the return of investment in the R&D is going to be more and more challenged, you know, and how we going to be making ourselves more efficient is going to be one of the key future, you know, which I see it personally myself. I, of course, as all the panel members said that, you know, well-being, health and well-being is a super critical growth driver, you know, it's going to be. I would like to extend that a bit more. I think Mani spoken also on that is about overall health and well-being, you know, which it's not about the functional ingredients I eat, the vitamins and minerals and things like that and seeing the benefit. That probably it's going to be much more holistic. You know, probably the consumers would like to see it more like, I like to eat natural food. I like to eat less processed food. That's something, you know, which possibly could be, but I can't crystal ball, but that might be one of the things, you know, which we are getting a weak signal. That's and also the last piece, which is that, you know, as you know, I don't have presentations. So is about the quality consciousness, the quality, the hygiene factor of the products, you know, that, you know, how do I really trust? How do I really trust the quality of the products? You know, how do I really see, trust the brand, you know, and how do I really, really believe that the product which is being offered to me is hygienically made? How do I have more transparency with the pack and the way it is, is sold to me as a consumers? So I think the consumer would expect it to be much more transparent, you know, world, you know, as we move it through, you know, and obviously the digital is going to help them, you know, and regulatory also going to help them, you know, in that process of journey. So with that, I'm going to stop, Kuldeep. I'm happy to take any questions after that.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Arijit. Looking at the way you have mentioned about the holistic figure, and particularly you have given first priority to the execution part. So you have given a, I would rather say, 360 degree kind of a view. And you have given maximum importance to the execution part, which is equally important, and understanding the consumer insights. Now, without because time is a bit constrained, but you know, I'm hesitating stopping any of our valued speakers just for the simple reason that talks are so interesting and so enriching that we want to, you know, fill our bags as much as possible.